If we know the value of the equilibrium constant, and we know all of the equilibrium concentrations or pressures except one, then we can calculate the missing value. This is easy. What is far more challenging is determining the composition of the system at equilibrium, given nothing more than the initial composition of the system and the equilibrium constant. We know none of the equilibrium pressures or concentrations. At first glance, we have multiple unknowns. However, we really only have one unknown, and that is how far the reaction goes towards the products or back towards the reactants. We solve the problem by constructing an ice table. The I refers to the initial values. We are given the composition of the system at the start of the reaction. Solids and liquids always have an activity equal to 1 and do not affect the value of the equilibrium constant. We can ignore them completely. We need only worry about the initial concentrations of any solutes and the initial pressures of any gases. We can place these values in the top row of the ice table. The next row in our table is the C row, where the C refers to the changes in the concentrations and pressures of the reactants and products. The initial concentrations and pressures have no obvious connection between them. However, the changes have a very clear connection governed by the balanced chemical equation. We need only introduce a single unknown, X. If a reactant gas has two molecules in the balanced equation, simply say that its pressure is reduced by an amount 2 times X. If a product solute has one molecule on the balanced equation, simply say that its concentration is increased by an amount 1 times X. The C line for any reaction is always the same, no matter what the initial and equilibrium values may be. All reactant and product gases and solutes have a term in X. For the reactants, a minus sign is in place, and for products, it's a plus sign. Finally, each term is multiplied by the coefficient in the balanced chemical equation. With the I and C rows now determined, the E row is merely the sum of the I and C values. This gives us the equilibrium concentrations and pressures. Only a single unknown X exists. At this point, we invoke the equilibrium constant's value. With it, we can solve for X and simply reinsert it into the E row to calculate the concentrations and pressures at equilibrium. One might ask what happens if the inverse reaction took place. This is a good question, but our approach is robust. If the inverse reaction would take place, the X value we obtain would simply be negative. Simply use that negative value as you would use the positive value. Finally, we could theoretically end with a linear, quadratic, cubic, quartic, or higher order equation in X. In this course, to make the calculations tractable, the problem will either yield a linear or quadratic equation. For the latter, the quadratic formula must be used, and two answers are generated. However, one answer makes sense and the other does not. To identify which value makes no sense, simply insert it into the E row. If a pressure or concentration at equilibrium is found to be negative, a physical nonsense, clearly this X will make no sense. Rest assured, one X value will make no sense, and the other X value will only generate positive concentrations and pressures. There can only be one true solution to the problem.